best at talking about mindset. I believe so anyway. So welcome, Kerry.
Thank you.
Awesome. I love those stories. That's fantastic. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. I thought I'd start off today with showing you a little video, take you back to 2000, Bondi Beach. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Anyone else went to the Olympics in Sydney? Yeah, did you go to the volleyball at all?
Yeah, I did.
You did? Did you go to the final?
I believe so.
Did you see you? You didn't see me? Maybe it wasn't the final then.
No.
That was another game.
Maybe I'm getting old.
Did you enjoy it? That's the main thing.
I always.
Awesome.
All right. The question was, did you see her?
No, she didn't. Yeah, she would have remembered. She would have remembered.
Mate, you were sorry, but you might have heard it.
Yeah.
Brandon, I know where you live.
Sorry, I
thought that was. Heard me or her?
No.
Oh,
certainly would have heard
me too. I actually just turned it on. Oh, look, you didn't just turn it on?
No.
Okay.
A famous speech has hosted many historical moments, but never an Olympic gold medal player.
What do you think?
As Australia's Kerry Potthast and Natalie Cook took on Brazil's Adrian Bahar and Shilda Betty in the best of three sets for the gold medal.
They take the lead, straight away Australia.
The Aussies race into a 3-1 lead and had a swing of legend to rev up the crowd. Potthast and Cook had only beaten Shilda and Betty three times in their 17 meetings, and the Brazilians showed their class to fight back and lead 10-6. But in a courageous fight back, Potthast and Cook saved two set points to level at the level all.
He saw it coming. Brazil in trouble. Score!
The Aussies getting some help to take the first set.
They won the first set. What a way to win it!
Potthast power serve reaching 85 kilometres an hour. The locals again shot clear in the second. For Brazil rallying to lead 7-3. Pushed by a fanatical hometown crowd, the Aussies came back yet again. Potthast and Cook getting to 11-10, Kerry with gold medal points.
Cook, they have won the gold medal!
It's sweet revenge for the Australians. Just 4 years ago in Atlanta, they were relegated to the bronze medal by the Brazilians.
Overcome, 35-year-old Potthast climbed the stands in search of a family.
I just can't believe it hasn't stuck in yet. I'm just so happy. And all my family, my friends, and everyone special for me today.
I couldn't believe it, and I had to have my cry.
The family split up for 2 years after Atlanta and then reunited as the Dream Machine has fulfilled every beach volleyballer's ambition.
Lock the room.
Puts his hand up. We'll lock the room.
Yeah. This one you can see. it's quite shiny. Where is it? It kind of looks gold, right? Yeah, it almost looks gold, isn't it? It's actually the bronze from Atlanta. And I remember coming home doing the Welcome Home parades here. In 1996, people would come up to us and go, wow, you've won a gold medal! And we'd have to go, no, it's just the bronze. So that's when the dream began, when people started thinking that we'd won a gold medal. And then, of course, the Sydney one, you can see, is a lot brighter. And we've actually just had this one re-dipped in gold. So that has had another fine layer of gold put on it by a jeweller in Brisbane because it was getting really daggy and tatty. And the ribbon, I had the Olympic Committee gave me another ribbon to put on there. That was so really fixed, but because it was getting dirty as well, but it's because I do this all the time and I shed them around.
So. I think that's amazing because that's sport, sharing.
Yeah.
Every time you're, like, literally, I was there shouting for you guys because I have a distant relationship with Natalie's front.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like friendship. And that's the thing, you guys seem to include people in your journey.
Exactly. It's all part of it. It's like being one big team, and I'll talk about that today. So what I thought I'd do with you guys today is take you through the journey, and specifically the journey between Atlanta and Sydney, so turning a bronze into gold. Is that pretty cool, what we did? I'm going to also get you to participate in something that you can do for your athletes. So I'm going to get you to do the exercise. So it's basically going to be called, it's going to be called a plan on page. You're going to actually be doing it today for yourself, not as if you're an athlete, but for yourself. And I'm going to take you through that process because it's all part of developing the mindset of a champion. Is that cool? Mm-hmm. Does that alright?
Yeah.
Awesome. So before we start, I thought I would just give you, tell you a couple little stories about how I got to, you know, the top got to beach volleyball, how it happened. But I wanted to share this story to kick us off because this is the moment that I realised what we'd achieved. This was not long after the Sydney gold medal match. Here we are in the streets of Bondi Beach with some of the locals, Backstreets, and Channel 7 with their camera about to do a live cross to the nation. Now the reason we're up there is because for some reason they couldn't get a cross signal down at the beach. They wanted to get us away from the crowds and do an interview not long after we'd won the gold medal. Now, as most of you know, straight after you've been in an Olympic final, you have to do a drug test, right? So after an hour and a half of playing volleyball, there's not a lot of fluid left in your body. So we knew that. We knew we'd have to do a drug test before we could do anything. So the first thing we did was drink a couple of bottles of water. We also had a beer because I knew that would make it come through quicker, and they do have beers in the Eskies in the rooms, and it was the end of the tournament. And then we did our sample. We didn't have to stay around too long. We were able to fill our cup. And then off we went with Channel 7 up onto this hill. So we're about to get interviewed. We're about 10, 15 minutes out from the interview. And all of a sudden, that fluid that I've just, that's bottles of water, that beer that I've drunk, was still making their way through my system. I'm like, I'm busting, but like, there's no bathroom around me. What am I going to do? And I asked one of the locals, I said, do you have one of these houses? Like, is this one of your houses? And this lady said, yeah, that's my house over there. I said, can I quickly use your bathroom? She said, yes, no worries. And we ran over the street. And the moment I realised that my life was going to be different was not particularly the moment they put that thing around my neck, that gold medal around my neck. Not the moment that I hit the ground and the whistle blew and I knew we'd won the match. But it was the moment I walked out of her bathroom because she just looked up at me and went, oh, I'm never going to wash my bathroom again. And yes, I've done this. So, you know, that's one of the little funny things that stick in your mind not long after. Obviously, the ceremony and all that, you know, it was a complete blur. And thank God, and I'm so grateful that I get to do this because I get to watch it all the time. And it still sends shivers up my spine when I see it. And I've probably seen it like hundreds of times, but, you know, it's really cool. But that was a moment that was sick. And I'm hoping one day someone will go, that's my mum's house. Well, that was my house because I tell that story all the time. But I actually didn't start playing beach volleyball, I started playing indoor volleyball. So most of you know indoor volleyball, you know, six-a-side, hard floorboards. And I started playing at the age of 17. I actually fell into volleyball because my brother came home from school one day and said, hey, Kerry, we've got a game of indoor volleyball at the local rec centre. Can you come and fill in, stand on the court, when the whistle blows, get out of the way so we can play the point. And that's how I was introduced to volleyball. And I went, older brother, good-looking friends, I'll come down, no worries. So I stood on the court, and instead of getting out of the way, I kind of bumped the ball around and probably looked like a complete goose. But I really enjoyed it. And at the end of the game, he just looked up and he looked down, he's taller than me, and he just said, maybe you'd be good at this game. Why don't you come to my club team? And that's how it all began. So pretty late in life, I wasn't one of those like 8-year-olds that dream of going to the Olympics. I had no dreams whatsoever back then. All I wanted to do was meet tall boys. And tall boys hung out at volleyball. So I went, okay, I'm gonna play volleyball. So my passion grew, and very quickly I became good at it. Hey, who knew? But I had great coaches. That was the thing. I think the thing that really made me a great player was my coach. And one of the best coaches, one of the best players in South Australia when I grew up, she became a coach, and she was amazing. And she got me through the first, I guess, 10 years of my indoor volleyball career. So 10 years I played indoor for Australia, green and gold tracksuit, had to pay for everything, just like your boys, just like you guys. Pay for your shoes, your socks, your rackets, everything. We didn't get any funding back then. I worked full-time as well. And I also played professionally in Italy, so I actually earned a little bit of money. I played in Bologna. Anyone, is badminton, do you have professional circuits, places where players get paid?
Yeah.
What's the country where the most money is?
Not
Italy.
At the moment, probably in league terms, India.
India, yeah. Yeah, so I had an opportunity to go and play with one of these teams, and I played for a year. It was fantastic. Unfortunately, it was also the last season I ever played, because when I came back to Australia, I was hoping to go back to Italy again. I quit my job to do all this, so I took a risk and quit my job and went to play professionally. I came back for the off-season, and I was representing Australia at the South Australia at the National Championships. I was on the right-hand side of the court, and I still remember I was going to smash this ball straight down the line in the grand final. I'd been playing all week. I'd been set the ball hundreds of times, so my muscles, my legs, everything was tired. The floor had quite a sticky surface as well. There'd been quite a few injuries that week, ankles and twists and things. And as I hit this ball at the last minute, I changed my mind. You're getting a bit sick there. Yeah, I changed my mind. I went to hit the ball cross. You won't like the next pictures then, so don't look. I changed my mind and I hit the ball cross court. It got blocked out. As that ball was landing, I thought, I'll get it myself. So I landed and I twisted, and in a split second, I've never had anyone react like that. My entire indoor volleyball career was in shatters, because I obviously completely ruptured my cruciate ligament, completely ruptured my medial ligament, rectal my meniscus and cartilage. So I completely trashed my knee. Who's had a knee injury? Yeah, pretty bad. Two ACLs, yeah. So I did that plus everything else, all in the one landing. I literally dislocated it completely. The girl behind me said your leg just completely dislocated, and I snapped back in because there was nothing left holding it. So over the next 3 months, I laid up on a couch. I had three major surgeries. First of all, I had the medial done. You can see the scar down here, and then they did the cruciate, and I did a patellar tendon cruciate back then. And then a couple of months later, I had a lot of scar tissue, and I had to go back in and remove all that, which is like a big golf ball size of scar tissue. So you can imagine how an athlete feels after dedicating their life, playing in Italy, feeling great, best player in the country, getting paid for something I love finally, and then it's just all completely taken away from me. So over the next few months, as I said, I also lost 10 kilograms because I literally couldn't do any exercise, so instead of getting fat, I got skinny. Go figure. I really couldn't get to the fridge. I couldn't get to the fridge and eat. I couldn't leave the couch. So I starved. No, I had people around me that brought me food. But every time I stood up, for about 2 months, it was like this. Every time I stood up, the blood would rush into the wound, and there was so much damage in there, it was like my knee was on fire. Even sitting on the toilet, I had to put my foot up on a stool, because even that angle, I'd be in such incredible pain, and sleeping was not difficult and everything. So I got quite depressed, as one would, and I thought, you know, it was over. Until my boyfriend gave me this. And this, in the beginning, was a brand new blank white volleyball. So the first thing I did when I got this was start crying, because I thought, what am I going to do? You know, how am I ever going to even walk properly again, let alone play volleyball? He said, Kerry, on every panel of this ball, I want you to write a goal, and then I want you to date that goal, and then bit by bit get back to doing what you love, and that's playing volleyball for Australia. So you can imagine what was going through my mind. I was 27 when this happened. I wasn't young. I'd never even sprained an ankle. I hadn't even busted a finger. Nothing. And here I was with one of the worst injuries you could possibly sustain. And all I could think of was, well, how am I going to get back to it? So, pardon?
This is like Tom Hanks.
Yeah. Well, of course. But the difference was, I wrote on that ball how I was going to get back. So bit by bit, I figured I'd work out. As I said, I'd never rehabilitated before. I didn't know what to do, but I started to try and work it out. I had a guess, right? Sometimes you know where you want to go, but you're not sure how you're going to get there. Just have a guess. So I thought, after 3 months, I'd get all the stitches out, I'd be able to kind of get myself out of the house, and I'd be able to run in the water, put a float belt on, and just do some running actions in the water, suspended. Then I figured I'd be able to jump. Then by that time, I'd be able to get on a stationary bike and move the leg around. And then I thought I'd be able to jog. Where does jogging come into knee injuries? Generally.
Not early.
Not early. See, I had no idea. I figured after, oh yeah, I'll be right, no problem, then I'll be able to jog. Well, I can tell you that never happened. It's never, ever happened. Didn't happen then, and it's never happened. Because the damage that I did to my knee, there's no way, especially because I kept on playing beach volleyball, there's no way I would like completely inflame that knee by going for a jog. But this one here is interesting too, because I had the ball, so I filled it out. And I had it at home, and I just had it sitting in the living room. So every time someone came over, they would go, oh, that's cool, look at that, oh, yeah. So they'd remind me. They'd go, oh, what's the month? Have you done this yet, Kerry? And I'd go, yes or no or whatever. Well, the boyfriend said at the end of February, he said, what's your goal? It's just, you know, we're just into March. What was your Feb goal? And I said, riding a bike. And he goes, have you done it? And I went, nah. So he went and got the bike out of the shed, dusted off all the dirt and cobwebs, and he made me ride the bike up and down the driveway, pretty much. So in my mind, I felt like I completed something and I could go on to the next goal. So that was so important. So when you're athletes, or even you personally, I'm talking to you guys as people, not just as coaches for athletes, but when you want something, put it out where you can see it. You've got to write it down. You've got to put a date on it, and you've got to put it where you can see it, because we're so bloody busy, aren't we? We've got so much stuff going on. I'm sure you're sitting here thinking about all the things you should be doing, but you've got so much stuff going on. So unless we remind ourselves every day of what we want to achieve, and this was perfect. It was written on the wall, the thing that I wanted to come back to play. And it was in front of me and everybody else. So there was one panel on here in the beginning that was blank, because it was where the valve was, and I figured, well, why write on there? Because when I sit it on the table like that, I won't be able to see it, right? So I didn't write anything on it. And then one day I picked it up, you know, rolled around, and I saw it was blank, and thought, what shall I write on there? Maybe, what could come after playing for Australia again, which was, I figured, competition match October 93, so just over a year from my injury, I figured I'd be able to play competitively again. I thought, well, haven't they just made beach volleyball an Olympic sport? Maybe I'll play beach volleyball. So I wrote beach volleyball on there, thinking, you know, that's too hard, that's not my thing, but I'll write it on there anyway. And then underneath, I've had a thought, and it's all worn out there, you can't really even see it, but underneath I wrote Atlanta, United States, 1996, thinking, oh, you know, Olympics. But, you know, straight after I wrote that, I just went, whoa, well, put that down, because that's not even, you know, in the thought process yet. I want to do all this other stuff first. I want to get back to playing indoor again, which I love. So that was the seed. That was the little seed that grew, because month by month, I tried, and after a year, I just realised that the floorboards were too hard for the injury that I'd sustained. I couldn't twist and turn the same. It just wouldn't work for me. So got myself a pair of purple leopard skin bikinis, leopard print bikinis, and got out onto the beach and started trying beach volleyball. And lo and behold, I realised that the sand was so much more forgiving on my knee, and I started a new career. So out of something so devastating, I was able to turn it around eventually by setting goals and having a new vision, and now I had a goal for the 96 Olympics. For 10 years, while I competed in indoor volleyball, Australia was ranked 25th or something in the world. They only take the top 12 to the Olympics. So we were so far out of Olympic qualifications, it didn't even occur to me that I could go to the Olympics. But now we already had one team on the beach volleyball tour and they were in the top 10 in the world. I'm like, oh, they want to go to the beach volleyball Olympics. So I did. I put that goal in my head and I'll show you in a moment what we did to get there. But for the next 10 years, obviously, I found myself getting very sandy. And of course, a couple of years later, I found myself at the Olympics with Natalie Cook. And so some of you might or may not know that Natalie actually went on. She's played 5 Olympic Games for Australia. She's the only female in this country, so I ended up playing 3. She played 5. Only female that's played 5 Olympics ever in Australian summer sports. Winter Olympics, they have, but summer sports, so that's pretty cool. But Natalie and I, our Olympic debut was pretty interesting because, as we all know, we need goals, right? So we were ranked number 6 in the world coming into the Games. So what would be a reasonable goal as coaches? You know, what would you expect your athletes to do? If you were ranked 6 in the world, what would be a reasonable goal going into an Olympic Games?
Bronze medal.
Would that be a goal? A medal? Yeah, a medal. Semi-finals, yeah, which is hopefully a medal. Yeah, fair enough. A medal. Well, that's exactly what we went for. We went for a medal. So I'll tell you what happened. Quarterfinal, up against the number one team in the world, in America, and they were American. So we had probably about 5,000 people on the second court, not in the big show court, but about 5,000 people screaming out, USA! USA! Between every point. And at one point, Natalie and I sat down and I just said to Nat, I said, God, that's really starting to get to me. She looked at me and she said, Kez? I said, what? She goes, turn the letters around. What does USA stand for? Oz! Exactly! She said they're cheering for us, they've just got it back to front! And of course that's exactly what happened. I started laughing, she started laughing, the whole situation kind of just relaxed a little bit. We went back out on the court, we're standing waiting for the serve, and they started chanting USA again. And so as they're chanting, we're just singing along with them, but we're going, A-U-S, A-U-S. I probably thought we were crazy. Like, what are they doing? Why are they singing USA? We're singing A-U-S. So we learned a massive lesson that it doesn't matter what happens to us, how you deal with it, it's how your athletes deal with it. That's what matters. So we obviously went on to win the quarterfinal, beating the favourite, gold medal favourite, in the quarter. We're like, sweet! We're almost at our goal, like we're right there, semis. Like that's almost our goal, right? We're almost at the medal. And then we were drawn like up against a Brazilian team in the semi-final, and we'd played them quite a few times. We'd won 50-50, so we had an amazing chance to win the semi-final at Atlanta. But what happened was, all we could think about was, but what happens if we lose? What happens if they beat us and then we lose the playoff and we finish fourth? That's not a medal, is it? What happens if we lose, don't lose? And we went into this match with so much fear of what would happen if we didn't win that game. Because that semi-final in the Olympics or in any tournament is so important if you're going for a medal. So what happened was we stepped on the court, we were so choked with fear and doubt that we choked. And we got smashed by this team that we'd beaten before. And I'll never forget coming home on the bus back to the village. And Natalie's chin was like literally stuck to her chest. She could not talk to us. She could not look us in the eye. She felt like it was all her fault. And it was. I was just checking to see. No, it wasn't. It was obviously our fault. But she couldn't talk to us. So we said, Nat, go away and have a massage. Go and get some TLC, get someone to make you feel good, and then come back and we'll need to talk about tomorrow because we need to go out there and win that bronze medal. So Nat, completely depressed about what had happened, because, you know, it's not like we just got beaten by a better team. We just got beaten by ourselves in that semi-final. So Nat went into the massage room, and normally there's hundreds of athletes and tables and therapists, all like in there helping, getting strapped, getting massaged, getting rubbed down, whatever. And that night she walked in and was empty. There's no one in there. And she's like, what a day. How's it? You know, it's just getting worse. And she's just about to leave, but she hears kind of all this murmuring she goes and has a look around the corner, and they're all crowded around this little TV set. 1996 was about this big. This little TV set. And they were watching the feed from the pool. I don't know if you guys will remember, but that night it was the men's 1500 metre freestyle final, and we had a guy in the final by the name of Kieran Perkins. So Kieran Perkins was in that final. He'd won gold in 1992, and he was coming back to win another gold. However, he'd only just made the final by 1/100th of a second, something crazy, like just a blink of an eye. So he was in lane 8. And everybody standing around that TV set was going, oh, lucky Kieran's in the final. He's not going to win. You know, he's just lucky he's in the final. At least he's kind of redeemed himself. He made the final, but he's not going to win. Everybody thought that. Commentators, people, everybody. But there was one person, obviously, who didn't believe that that night, and that was Kieran. Because when he dove off the blocks, when the gun went off, he was ahead within the first lap. And he stayed ahead, and he just increased that lead, and he stayed ahead. And for 15 minutes, Nat stood there and watched this. And the adrenaline in this room with all the athletes and the therapists was just getting bigger and bigger. All the Aussies, they were just going, yeah, come on, Kieran, go right. Yeah, and he wins. And Natalie's just like lifting off the floor, levitating on her own just from excitement. And she's like, I don't need a bloody massage. I'm going to go out and win a bronze medal. So she was so inspired that night. Thank you, Kieran, because it was exactly what we needed to get over what had happened. So I love that story because there is so much inspiration around us. And just you bringing me in today is an example of how you can share other people's inspiration. When your athletes are down, bring in people to help inspire them. Or tell stories, tell this story. Find another story, get them to read about other athletes, get them to have books with them on tour so they can read other athletes' inspirational stories on how they deal with stuff. Because when people see other people can do it, they get inspired and they do it as well. So obviously we went out the next day, guess what country we were playing again? In the US.
AUS?
Yeah, no, not AUS, bloody USA again. But we were armed with our words. Every time they started chanting USA, USA, we turned. So yeah, we work pretty much. Yeah, I get you.
I was thinking, you're backwards.
Yeah, exactly. So we came home with that bronze medal, which we were obviously pretty proud of. But this is where the journey started. For me, this is where it started. Because, great, getting there, we got there purely on talent. But what we needed next was mindset. Because just on talent, compared to the rest of the world, we didn't train as much. We didn't play as high-level competition frequently as much as the rest of the world. Would that be the same in your sport? Especially in Australia, we don't get the same amount of exposure that the best players in the world out there get. So we thought, what can we do to kind of catch up? And we knew that it was mindset. We knew that it was mindset. We just weren't sure how to do it. So we got somebody to help us, and we came up with this. And this is the key to what I'm going to talk to you about today. Now, I know you can't even read that. There is a copy in my book, and I'm going to give a couple of these away today, but if anyone wants to buy my book, everything I'm talking about today is in here. All the athletes that I've ever given it to absolutely love it, so have a look through it. But this is our plan, this is our Olympic plan. It's called Gold Medal Excellence. The first thing I want to do is tell you why it's called Gold Medal Excellence. Going into Atlanta, our goal was a medal. Well, thank goodness we got the last one, right? We salvaged it and got that medal. Going into Sydney, our coaches obviously said to us, so what's your goal now? What would it be, do you think?
Has to be gold.
Has to be gold, right? Yeah, we said gold. And then I said, well, we went for a medal, we got the last one. If we go for gold, maybe we can get silver or another. Like, is there something more than gold than we could go for? Something greater than gold? And Natalie's pretty cheeky, so she goes, oh, what about a platinum medal? That's more expensive than gold. And we're like, well, it's not really real. Like, you need to go for something that's actually tangible and real. So we came up with a strategy. Our coaches said to us, what if for the last 2 years leading into the Sydney Olympics, so from 1998 onwards, we would just act like gold medalists? We would live our lives with gold medal excellence. We would train like gold medalists train. We would eat like gold medalists eat. We would rehabilitate. We would talk to the media with the confidence of the gold medalists. We'd stand on the court with our shoulders back as if we were gold medalists. We'd come off the court every day going, that was how a gold medal player trained. That was what we decided to do. For 2 years leading into that, we acted as if. So think about it. Like, we're always saying, oh, yes, we're going to be, if we to win a gold medal, we're going to be like this. Or to win, we're going to be like this. But why wait until that moment? If we'd waited till the 25th of September 2000 to start to be a gold medalist, it would have been too late, right? We had to start doing it beforehand. So we decided to call our plan Gold Medal Excellence, to live our life with Gold Medal Excellence. And I still live my life with that. That's what I've learned. And this became our motto. How can we make it better? Because we learned from Atlanta that stuff's going to happen. Shit's going to happen. Like, people are going to get injured. You're going to lose. This, you know, flight's going to be cancelled. You're going to miss stuff. Like, stuff's going to happen. But every moment, every time that stuff happens, we're going to ask ourselves, how can we make it better and move on? So that became our motto. Then we had these four categories. We're going to go through them. We're going to actually do this today as a group. So this is our why, our purpose. Why did we want an Olympic gold medal? So we had things on there like to have a better quality of life, self-discovery, to become improved individuals because of our shared experience, to be the best in the world, to see the world and make new friends. Every moment, every day I woke up, if I read this, there's no way I wouldn't want to go to training. There's no way I would feel bad. I'd be like, yeah, that's why I'm doing this. That's why we're sacrificing what we're sacrificing because of this, our why. To create new and better opportunities, to greatly increase our income. Still working on that. We first put to increase our income, then we thought, hey, why not put it up to greatly increase our income? To leave our mark in history, to represent Australia, to inspire and lift others' hopes and dreams. So back then, Natalie and I occasionally would do a speaking job. Now we both speak all the time. But it's because that was one of our reasons. That was one of the things that we thought, if we can win a gold medal, that's our vehicle to be inspiring other people. We planned that. I planned to be here today. I planned to be here today. How many years? 18 years ago. To make friends around the world, be better at our craft, and to enjoy the journey. We figured, hey, this is going to be fun trying to get a gold medal. It's going to be a fun thing. Then we had our code of conduct, and it starts with we will. And this was our rules that we set as a team. So we went away on a team building activity, and we set all this together in the plan, and then our coaches put it in the rings, which, again, perfect, because that's what we were going after. So it's visual and colourful. Respect others and their opinions. Use deeds rather than words. Do whatever it takes. Be responsible for empowering communication. Because just like your game in doubles, if you're communicating with your partner, there's only two of us, there's no subs, right? And you're disempowering them or taking their power away with a negative comment or something that's not making them feel good, you're wrecking your team, right? So we had to be consciously aware of the fact that we were empowering each other, making each other feel really good and uplifted. Even if it meant that we had to constructively criticise them in some way or give them some feedback or just push them to a new level, we always had to try to be empowering. Be compassionate and understanding towards all our team members. Be committed to constant daily improvement. So every day our coach would come, we'd come off the court and our coach would say to us, what did you improve on today? But every day we had to try and improve just a little. And if we were able to do 1%, if we were able to do 10%, any small percentage, you string those together daily, and the improvement is really, really amazing. But you have to be committed to the improvement. You can't just come in and get on the court and do the do, and, you know, as a coach, your players just tell your players what to do and they're just there brainless. They have to actually be committed to improving on something each day. Our success coach, I'll tell you more about him in a sec, but he had tattoos. He used to be an actor in Hollywood. Funny story. But he had a tattoo on his wrist and it had C-A-N-I. He had C-A-N-I, constant and never-ending improvement. He actually had that tattooed on his wrist to remind him every day. Well, look at it and say, what can I be better at today? Maybe it's just being better to my wife. Maybe it's just, you know, saying hello and chatting to the person who's giving me a coffee or something. How can I be better today? Be flexible, professional, always present a unified front by sticking together. I'm not going to lie to you, it's not fun travelling the world just with a two-person team. You know, I don't know, you guys travel in teams, a lot of you are individuals, some have doubles obviously, but we're just two of us, that's it, there's no singles, there's no nothing. I rely on her, she relies on me. And we're not the same sort of people, but we have the same goal that keeps us together. And if other teams see that we're a little bit shitty with each other or something's going on, they'll stick the wedge in and they'll just keep on banging in that wedge, you know, which for us is serving down the middle or something like that. Or just, you know, the things they say to us. They see that there's, it gives other people confidence, basically, if they see there's trouble in your world. So we, even if we didn't like each other, we would still make sure we had breakfast together in the hotel that morning at the same table. You see other teams like on the opposite sides of the dining room and you know that there's something going on. Stay focused on our journey, on our outcome, sorry. Have fun and enjoy the journey. So that was a rule. It was a rule. So as coaches, make sure your players are having fun, that it's actually set in your plan to enjoy what they're doing. Fun is really, really important. Winning is better, and it's more fun when you win. maintain a good and healthy eating regime, always drive forward, never give up. So those were the sorts of rules that we had that we put together. The green circle is our winning way, and that was all about volleyball. So you could probably take a lot of this and throw it straight into your sport. We had things like intimidate the champion's physiology. Mm. You know, if you walk out the court and your players are so you're looking like, I'm going to get happen. Well, you will get happen. So we had to walk out and act like shoulders back and be strong and confident, look like we were strong. Even if inside we were shaking. We had to act like that. Use our strengths to attack our opponent's weaknesses. I can't even read that because I don't normally read it out. Execute our game plan. Push at the start, gain momentum, hold, push at the end. I'm only reading this to you guys because it's kind of very similar, right? Challenge the passes with our service pressure. Kick the ball outside the gift circle. Do you ever say anything like that? I mean, that basically means play out, play the lines. You know, don't play in the middle of the court. It's terrible. Read one here. What else did we have that might interest you? Recognize, take opportunities. Create, ride the momentum. Touch everything. That means basically don't let anything hit the ground. And for me, just like you were saying, like sun and the beach and that, I don't like sand. I don't like sand. It's actually true. When I go to the beach, I have to get every grain of sand off me at the end of the day. So there is stuff that you have to go through in order to reach your goals that you just might not want to do. And even as coaches, you might not want to have that conversation with your player, but you have to. There's stuff that you have to do in order to reach your goals, and I had to get over getting all sandy. And I know when you watch beach volleyball in Rio, I'm going to be there mentoring now, or actually I'm going to be looking after the sponsors, drinking pina coladas in the stand, and maybe mentoring athletes if they want to give them. But I'm going to be there, and you're going to be watching the athletes. It's going to be really hot. They're going to be shining because they're going to be so sweaty. But imagine the ball's like 10 feet away, and you've got this rule that nothing hits the sand, right? So you just have to dive, fly full out, you get completely covered in sand, you stand up literally feeling like a schnitzel. And I'll tell you, the sunscreen just is like the egg of the schnitzel, it just makes it stick. So, sand, it just gives me shivers. My coach would make me get covered in sand, literally do a drill where I had to roll around in the sand before training even started, before even I had a ball involved, because then at least I was covered and I didn't worry after that. So I knew that I had to touch everything. Leave our guts on the court was the last one. And then finally, and this is where I think, when I speak to corporate groups, this is where they really start to get it. Because this last one, we called our standard of champions. So this is who you need to be, who your players need to be a champion. So how did we work that out? What's the most simple way to work that out?
Observe other champions.
Bingo. Observe other champions. We looked around, we looked at all the gold medalists that went before us, not in our sport only, but in all sports. Champion tennis players, champion football players, champion anybody. And we also looked at successful people in business. Because why, you know, why can't that overlap? That can overlap, right? So we looked at all these people and we went, what is it we can be better at? So we had things like be strong in emotion and spirit, be powerful and certain, passionate, committed, trusting of the system and process. Our coaches, some of them were younger than me. I had more of volleyball experience, but I had to trust that they were taking you to where you wanted to go. Like, you might be coaching, again, I'm coming because you're young, right? Or are you old? I don't know, you're young. You're young? Yeah, I guess. You might have. But some of you as coaches, you're probably young too.
Yeah.
Oh, you're young? Oh, sorry, yeah.
I knew you were going
long way. Yeah.
You're right on there, because I have a lot of people that I work with are my age or older.
Yeah.
Or have had more experience,
yeah.
Yet I'm trusted to give something, especially in business. So
yeah.
That's.
So we figured as players, we need to have that trust. So this is something you can help your players with, to have that trust. Get them to understand that if they don't have that trust, if they don't follow what the game plan is or the system or whatever you're trying to teach them, they're not going to get their best results. They're not, because they're going to be fighting, there's always going to be doubt in their head. So we had to be really trusting of the system and the coaching. Perceptive, clear and focused, flexible, outcome driven, and follow through. You know, you hear a lot of times these days people talk about outcome, like forget the outcome, just don't think about the overall goal, let's just do the process, right? But I don't know if that's a cop-out. But, or, you know, they don't really believe. I believe you need to focus on the outcome. I believe you need to focus past the outcome. We focus after the Olympics. We sat down and worked out, what are we going to do once we've won the gold medal? We're going to go and have our drug test. Then we're going to go party. Then we're going to do all these interviews. And then we're going to do, and we actually planned out what was going to happen after. This stuff in here, be able to lift others' hope and be able to inspire and lift others' hopes and dreams. That was for after. So we were thinking about after the medal as well. So I truly believe you need to focus on the outcome, winning, being number one, but then of course you need to plan how to get there, and then you need to focus at the time on what you need to do, but you always have to have the outcome. It's like vision boards, right? Who's heard of a vision board? Who's ever done a vision board? Maybe, yeah? Do you still have it where you can see it? And what does it do for you every day?
Gives a very visual kind of idea of, oh, am I going there? No.
Yeah. Helps you make decisions. Yeah. Doesn't, and inspires you. So that's the outcome. That vision board is your outcome. So we also had compassionate and loving on there. Because we didn't want to have that gold medal around our neck and have a lot of, you know, haters or people that weren't supportive of us, that weren't there to celebrate. We wanted to include our family. You said we were very inclusive.
Yes.
And we wanted to, you know, we wanted people to still like us, we wanted to have friends. Because you obviously, to win a gold medal at any level, you have to be completely focused and driven, and that can drive people away. So we wanted to make sure that we still were that close type of people. And the last one on there is having fun. So this fun on here, that was why Aurora was having fun. This is fun for us anyway, except for Sam Park. And having fun was the type of people we wanted to be. So there's a bit of a common thread in there. You've got to keep it fun. You've got to keep serious, driven, focus, everything else, but have a bit of fun. So we're going to have a bit of fun now.
Wait, can I ask a question?
Yes.
Just in regards to acting like a champion, I have a lot of people that I've seen, one, especially with juniors, they watch their mentors. So they become the embodiment of, look at me, you know, I have confidence. But for me, if you don't actually have substance behind that confidence, meaning aka experience in, okay, a lot of people from my sport, they like a player called Taufik. Taufik was what you could call a blasé kind of player. And they would follow him and say, no, relax. And one of my coaches earlier on said, he's very relaxed, but underneath, he's actually working quite hard at what am I doing, what am I doing tactically. And a lot of the players are like, yeah, you can look relaxed, but what was that backhand for? Did you just do a backhand in a double match, a backhand smash and double match? How do you, to younger athletes, include a learning and growing exercise with that presence of, yes, I believe the embodiment, or I am the embodiment of courage and whatever you want to say. And that.
So they feel it rather than just act it.
Yeah.
Sometimes, first of all, I've got to say, sometimes you've got to fake it till you make it. You do have to fake it till you make it. you do have to do that a little bit, because inside you might be shaking with fear.
Yeah.
And it's the same with speaking. You know, if I ask some of you to stand up here for an hour and talk, you'd be like, you know, what am I going to say around my peers? And, you know, and so when I first started speaking, I had to fake it. I had to act like I was confident, but inside I was shaking with fear. But eventually, with this sort of planning that we're going to do next, exactly what we're going to do right now, this is going to give them the confidence. Because half of building confidence is knowing that you've done the work, right?
Yeah.
Half of feeling like you can get out there and win the point, win the set, win the match, is knowing that you've done all the training. But add on top of that, knowing that you've done all the mental preparation at the same time, then really you can create unstoppable athletes, right? Because for me, there are only three areas of an athlete. There's the skill, the sporting skill. There's the physical ability, so, you know, obviously all the strength and conditioning work that they need to do to become the best physical specimen. And then at the end of the day, their mindset. And it's no good, and I've really been disappointed with our sport, please keep this in this room, over the last probably 10 years, we have not spent enough time on mindset. So we've got players going to the Olympics that are absolute specimens.
Mm-hmm.
They're absolute so amazingly physical. And the trouble is they still lose. Just last weekend they lost to Finland. And no offence, but Finland's not a good nation in our sport. So to me there's something missing. They're just about to go to the Olympics. They're a medal contender. They've beaten most of the teams in the world.
That's a
bit of a point. You don't know what we're doing next, but I'm going to show you. But that doing this sort of planning, I think having the mindset on top of everything else will help you build that confidence. But in the beginning, they have to fake it a little bit. But as long as you keep, you know, telling them to dig deeper and work out what is it that
what
creates
is, yeah,
that.
The knowledge behind the confidence.
Yes.
Because it's so easy to fake it till you make it, but a lot of them are fakes. You just
poke. How about writing this down? Courage comes before confidence.
That's
courage. Comes before confidence. So it's the courage to take the risk, it's the courage to do the planning, and that will give you the players the confidence. Okay, so what we're going to do is something that I've done. Here's a couple of examples. I don't know if you can see them, but that's the one I did with the Roosters, the under 20 boys, the NRL team. I took them through a similar session, and this was for Swimming Australia. I took a lot of their swimmers a couple of years ago. I've done gymnastics and obviously volleyball. So what we're going to do next is we're actually going to do a process that you can take your teams through in a similar way, or you can, you know, cut and paste or whatever. So this is called a plan on the page, and it's basically going to give you a few things that you can start to sit down with them and find out what they want to achieve, how they're going to do it, and who they have to be. Okay, so this, we're going to do it today for you. This is you thinking about your life and about the goals and yourself as if you are you. You and I want you to experience it and think about what goes through your head, and then you can take this away and create something similar for your players to help them with their mindset. So, the first thing we're going to do, my hand are out of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you need one of those. Values, if what you value in life does not align with the goals that you want to achieve, it's not going to work, right? So has anyone ever done this before, a value exercise? This is a list of values to kind of get you thinking. The first thing I want you to do is just read through these values, put a ring around the ones that jump out. Put a ring around the ones that you feel are important to you.
As many as you want.
As many as you want right now for the first bit. So just put a ring, yeah, put as many rings around. Whatever's important to you. Don't think about any, no one's going to look at this. It's what's really deep down important to you. What I want you to do is fill out the first part here, where it says my core values.
Yeah.
So obviously you can't fit them all on there. I want you to put about 10, 5, like however many, the ones that you think are really, really, really super important. It might start off with family, might start off with your career, could be anything. Trust, obviously, it's very important.
So 10.
Up to 10, yeah. the ones that are really, really important to you personally. So the reason that we do this is to just make sure that when we set our goals that they actually are in alignment with our values. So for instance, if your goal is to be the coach of the number one team in Australia, yet one of your values is...
Lacking.
Yeah, or one of your values is just to spend time watching TV or something, or spend your weekend, I don't know, going kayaking or whatever, then obviously that's not going to work because you need to dedicate a lot of time to your athletes, right? So it's just a really good job to make you realise that the goals really need to align with your values. So you can change your goals, but often you can't really change your values. Your values might change when you have family or when you transition from a career into another new career, but generally you can't really change your inside thoughts. It's a lot harder. So what we're going to do now is have a look at the goal setting process that you can also take your athletes through. So I like this because what happens if they don't set goals? Well, there's a lack of clarity around, you know, where am I going? Like it's like going out in a car and not setting the GPS, having an address but having no idea how to get there. It's also going to cause people to procrastinate if they don't have a goal in mind. They're just going to sit back and go, I might do it later, or I'm going to do it, because you don't really know what you're doing. And of course, they'll give up. They'll give up as soon as something, a challenge or there's some resistance because they haven't got that dream together. So for Natalie and I, because we had the dream of gold medal excellence and winning gold in Sydney, and that was our focus, our outcome, I tell you what, along the way, there would have been many times where I would have given up playing if I did not have that goal. And, it's like going on your own healthy regime, whether you want to, get ripped in the gym or whatever. You've got to have a goal, because going to the gym each day can get quite boring if you're not working towards something or changing a healthy eating regime or something. So I just want to tell you a quick little story about why we need these goals to be big. Goals need to stretch us and our athletes. I did this talk once on International Women's Day to a group of women, and this girl came up to me at the end, and I talked about setting goals and my goal ball and everything. She goes, I loved all your goal setting stuff. She said, I've just done my HSC. Everyone know what HSC? Everyone's listening. That's like your last year of school, high school certificate. And the score was out of 100, and my goal was to get 97. And I do 97 on everything. I had a big 97 in my room. I wrote 97 everywhere. I understand what you're talking about because that's what I did. It was, I wrote it everywhere. And I said, oh, that's really cool. I said, but, you don't seem that kind of happy about it. And I said, what did you actually get? She goes, I got 97. I said, that's fantastic. That's awesome. That just goes to show, that girls. She goes, yeah, but I wish I had gone for 100. Imagine. It stopped her there. It stopped us in Atlanta going for a medal. It stopped us in the semi-final. So think about your players and what their goals are and what your personal goals are. If you limit yourself, if you limit that ceiling, that's as far as you get, and you'll self-sabotage. So make sure it's a stretch to get there. Make sure it's a stretch, because if they go for the win and they finish second and their last result is 10th, that's fantastic as well. It's got to be realistic, right? They've got to be within some sort of reach of it, but make sure it's a stretch. So, what if? I want you to close your eyes for a sec. Everyone close both eyes. I want you to listen for a minute, because this is going to take you into the goal setting part. If you were right here and now, the person you most wanted to be, so this is about you, not about your players, this is about you. So close your eyes. If you were the person you most wanted to be, what would you be doing? If you were completely free to express your most dearly held dreams and visions, how would you do that? What if you were wealthy enough to buy anything in a book at all in the world? There was no limitation. There was no limitation as to how you would use that wealth. What would you do with it? What if you had the time, the money, the knowledge, the energy, and the resources to pursue your highest vision? What would you seek to do? If you were free from all things that limit you, that hold you back, in what direction would you really go? What do you really want in your life? If you could achieve anything, be anyone you wanted to be, where would you travel to? Where would you live? Who would you want in your life? What sort of lifestyle would you have? What's your wish list? If you could have anything and do anything, I could give you a magic wand. I want you to open your eyes. I want you to turn over your plan on the page or get a blank piece of paper, and I want you to just flow right. I want you to write everything that came into your mind, anything and everything.
Didn't change the thing.
Write that down. I'll be right here, right now. But anything, if you were given $1 million, what's your name?
Ed.
If you gave you $1 million, who would you give it to? Because there are people in this world that you aren't giving money to right now. How would you help the world? Like, just think past the limitations of what you have now in your life. What would you be doing? What's your ultimate dream? We all have dreams deep inside as adults that have been squashed by things around us, by circumstances, by family. What would you be doing? One of the people that you can remember from the Sydney Olympics, the difference between the photo Natalie and I have and the photo that one of our athletes who won the 400 metres, who was that?
Captain Freeman, running.
Remember when she won and she hit the deck? What was the number one emotion going through her head?
Relief.
Why was that?
Pressure.
But what was the emotion that she had leading into that?
She must do this.
But what was she going through? Was she happy about it? No, what was she feeling?
Anxiety.
Or starts with F.
Fear.
She was so scared. So she didn't have that assistance. She didn't have that mindset. So our journey was so very different. We had such an abundant mindset. We didn't think about it. We didn't possibly entertain the thought. We just thought, this is what we're doing. We'll deal with it later if it doesn't happen. But right now, we're going to deal with, this is what we're doing. This is how we're going to get there. This is what we're going to feed our minds. So you've got a few dreams sitting there. So what I want you to do now is pick two goals, just two. So you've got space on your plan on the page, and you've got today's date, or June 2016, to put it at the top. So I want you to and down the bottom, June 2017. So 2017 at the bottom is going to be the goal you want in a year's time. So pick a goal that has about a 12-month thing on it out of your list, and put that at the bottom, but I want you to write it as if it already is. So, do you understand what I mean? So I want you to write it as if it already is. I am at the, or I am coaching this, or I am doing that, or I have the car that I want, or the boat that I want, or the house that I want, or whatever it is. So give yourself, within that sort of 12-month period, so if you can make it about 12 months from now, at the bottom, write it as if it already is. I've written at the top here, that's wrong, sorry, it's at the bottom of the box, at the bottom of the box, and at the top of the box, I want you to write where you are now. I've done two devices. At the top of the box, write where you are with that goal right now. And then you can use backwards or forwards planning, and this is really interesting, especially in sports. So at the back of, this one's not. So at the bottom for us, it was obviously Sydney gold medal, right, and beyond. At the top, it was like we were ranked number 3 in the world. We'd never won a tournament. We'd only ever, I'm 7th or 3rd. We actually never won a tournament before Sydney. So there's a lot of anxiety. We could have been a lot of anxiety opposed to that, but we attached to that, but we wouldn't let that in because we were too abundant with positive thoughts. Then you might use backwards planning from Sydney and go, okay, to win the gold medal, one of the things we need to achieve by a certain date is beating everybody in the world, or winning this tournament, or doing that. So you can start to break down and be specific about how you're going to get there. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like so it's obviously not something that you can do right now in 5 minutes, but I'm going to give you 5 minutes to have a go. Here's an example of a weight loss. Oh, sorry, no, I took that out. This is an example. So when I first wanted to write my book, I put it at the top here. I wanted to launch my book at the Sydney Schoolgirls Breakfast. I actually launched my book here in 2010 in this hallway at the Sydney Schoolgirls Breakfast. So I went backwards and I planned out how I was going to get there. And I put this about a year before. So I had some chapters and content. I'd already decided it. I finalized Sarah, who was a friend of mine, to help me write it. I started writing. Write, find a copywriter, confirm titles and subtitles, find a printer, get a distributor, get the back cover done, front cover done, register the book, final draft to printer, boom. So that's how I split it up in order to get to that day. So what I did, I said, I didn't say I'm going to write a book. Who wants to write a book? When's it going to come out? Do you think it ever will?
Yeah.
When's it going to come out?
It's so good.
What date is it going to come out? What date are you going to have the book in your hand? Put the pressure on you now.
No.
Give me a date.
No, it's more or less a secret between two people, but I'm going to share.
Maybe. Oh, you don't have to tell us what the book is, but just the date.
2018.
2018. What month?
Hopefully May.
May? Does it coincide with something else happening in May? Cool. Awesome. So that's exactly what I did. I went, I'm going to write a book, but if I didn't put a date on it, this would still be in my head. This would still be in my computer. It wouldn't be in writing. So I had to put a date on it, and I decided that what a better way to launch it at an event. So I made sure that they knew I was launching it there. So I had to do it. You actually have to do it. So it's not going to get done unless you put a date on it. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you've got to put a date on it. So that's the power of the plan, is that with your athletes, you can do this as well. Because it's easy, because you have events. How are you going to get there? What do you need to do? What do you need to do physically, strategically, mentally? Well, the first thing we need to do is make a plan. That's maybe the first thing they have to do. Have a look at what their weaknesses are and start to factor in all the strengths, how you can build those within the period of time that you've got. So I'll give you a couple more minutes. Try and fill in some gaps. If you don't know, just make it up. Because it can change. The plan can change. It's not set in cement. You're going to allow people to express themselves, and you're going to allow them to fail. But we know that. But if we can put some plans around it, if we actually can try and systemize it and put some solid plans around it, then it's not just words.
Yep.
And it gives them the confidence. Okay, so you can have a go, finish that off later, but I wanted you to experience that, so you start to think, and you can do that. Do people see how you can do this with your players so far? And you can break it down? Have you ever done anything like this with your players?
Yeah.
Yeah? Cool. Think deeper than what you've done before as well next time you do it. Think of what you can add in there where it's not just about badminton. It's not just about their physical abilities, that it actually might be about their mental abilities as well. You know, and how you can add fun in there, how you can put different things in there to really inspire them. Yeah? Okay, so the other part of our gold medal excellence plan was our purpose, why. So what I want you to do now is go to your whys on your plan on a page, and I want you to list as many reasons as you can for why you want the goal that you've just done. Just the one that you've just started working on. Why do you want it? What is it going to mean to you if you achieve this goal that you've just written down? This becomes your why, and there's a box on your plan, on your planner, where you can fill this in. It's called my purpose, or my why if you want. What is it going to mean to you if you achieve this goal? Why do you want it in your life, and how's it going to make you feel? This is a really good one to ask your kids or your adults. Remember, the goals for your athletes have to be their goals as well. They have to come up with them, not you. It's much you want it for them. If they don't have that goal in their own heart, they're going to play with fear of disappointing you. That's it. No more reasons?
Too many reasons were
too many?
Too many reasons were overplayed. I just need one reason.
You just need one reason?
Me.
And then it's all within that reason? Yeah. All the others?
Decide what you want to, because often then the decision is made based just on I have to do something, because if I don't, then that has consequences, of course, for, you know, finance, family, and things like that. So it'd be great to be able to take time off to actually consider what it is that you're good. And if I could have that opportunity, it'd be great. I'm not saying that I'm treating myself, I have not. But sometimes you have to think, oh, well, you know, I've done, been in this industry all my life, don't know what it would be like or something. I wonder what it would be. So sometimes.
So how much time would you need, do you think, to work that out? So how much time could you take off to not affect the rest of your life, your family?
I'm in a forced situation. I could probably take off as long as I want to.
How much time would you like to take?
He's not doing anything.
I thought you were going to say
is that an empowering comment?
It's very empowering. Just confirms that I should really start now. It's difficult.
Start tomorrow.
Yeah. So, do you see what I'm questioning that I'm doing? I'm trying to get your goal more specific.
Yeah. And I understand that it's one of those things that it's very hard to put time around it. Because I could be in a, like I said, could probably be in a situation where I don't need to rush to anything.
Okay.
And it could be that after 3 weeks I'm already cigarette and I need to go back to what I was doing because I miss it too much or whatever.
So when could you perhaps start taking that sabbatical?
That's a bit hard. I shouldn't have colleagues in the room, I guess. My responsibilities.
Okay, let's just imagine that you said in 6 months' time. So for the purpose of the exercise, you would write, I am on sabbatical, and that would be 6 months from now.
Yeah.
And then you start to think about where that might be and who that might be with, and then you work out, well, what do I need to do in the next 6 months from now to then to prepare yourself to go on sabbatical?
Yeah, that's
perfect, thank you. And your why? You've pretty much explained that. To work out what
why is, I don't get too philosophical, I guess, but
why not?
Just to have time to consider whether this is what I want to do going forward, to have a break, really, to spend as much time with my kids while they're in an age where it's important to try and help the kids get ahead in life.
There's some pretty amazing whys there, some pretty strong reasons for why that wants to happen. And this is what you need to do for your kids, for your athletes, is find out what they really want, but why they want it. And that will help dispel the fear. If they know what they want, not what you want for them or what the other team wants for them, then that will help dispel the fear around that. Does that make sense? That was a great share. Thank you. I think the more specific, the better. So if you don't know what that's going to look like in 12 months, make it a 6 month goal.
So just keep bringing it down until you can be specific.
Or it might change the goal because obviously you might not be able to achieve the same amount in 6 months. Can you give us an example? Or if you're thinking of for yourself or for an athlete or
no, like even just thinking for myself, like if I didn't even know exactly. Like, I can't really define where I want to be in more than a year's time. Does that mean that?
Well, think back, where do you want to be in 6 months?
Have short-term goals.
Yeah. So this is just an example of a time frame. So some of you, with sport, it's easy because you have events that are planned, that are in the calendar. But with life, about what you want to achieve in your career, it might be a bit more difficult. So just start with 6 months maybe and work back. Get to that 6 month. And then part of that 6 month goal might be, okay, from this point now I want to work out what I want to do in another 6 months.
So
as
soon as you've got like a specific goal, that's your
sort of there's no have to or must, but whatever goal you make sure it is specific.
Okay.
If we just have the goal as have it to take a sabbatical, that might happen next month, next year, in 10 years. It may never happen because you'd be like, oh yeah, I want to have the sabbatical. I want to have that holiday. But it never happens because you haven't actually put a date on it and you haven't worked out what you need to do to get it. Yeah? Can anyone relate to that where they've had something that they wanted? Who's wanted to do something for the last 5 years but hasn't done it yet? Anyone? Can you think of anything? It's probably everyone has got something that they want to do, and it always is always something, unless you put a specific goal. Unless you put some specifics on the goal and you put a date on it and you have that little plan around it, it's not going to happen. And that then stays a dream. That's what a dream is. The dream is to have the sabbatical. It becomes a goal once he puts a date on it about when it's going to start. Some people are good at being courageous. Some people are good at taking risks. But some people aren't. Some people are good at setting goals and never achieving them because they don't do the work to get there. That's the other thing. It's easy to set a goal and have a time limit and work out how you're going to get there. But if you don't actually complete the steps in the next 6 months to make that sabbatical happen, then it's not really a goal either. So it's the action. So once you get your athletes to set their goals and you've worked out exactly, really specifically how they're going to get there, then they've got to commit to constant daily action, right? Constant daily improvement. Does that make sense? So it's very simplistic. I mean, we do talk about goals, but we do set goals, but you know, there's probably bits and pieces that maybe you've missed along the way with some of the athletes, and they need to really honor them. So involving them in the process obviously is incredibly important. So the why is the emotion. The why will make it happen, right? The why will get them up early in the morning to go and train in the morning. The why, you know, the family. If you write those things down, I bet you anything you'll be on sabbatical within 6 months. If you write down what it means to you and how it's going to make you feel when you're there. We're going to keep picking on you. But even with your career, if you write down what it's going to mean to you and if you really get attached to that feeling, like for us, how's it going to mean standing on the podium? Oh my gosh, having achieved a lifelong dream at 35 after wrecking my knee and never thinking I'd ever, that's going to be the most incredible. And being attached to that why makes you do all the actions to get there. If you don't have a strong enough why, you're not going to get there.
What if you fail?
So what? You get up, you go again.
Before you actually succeed, you've got a pathway because you've got a part of the way towards your goal.
Really?
So that each stage is an accomplishment.
Pardon?
Same, you know, you have your ultimate goal there, but if you fall off at some point, you still actually potentially achieve several layers on it from there. So you've actually reached certain parts of that goal,
absolutely,
but not the overarching.
In Atlanta, we failed winning a gold or a silver, the medal.
That fail was not a bad fail, you see.
It wasn't a bad fail.
In your eyes, it's not in her eyes.
But in our eyes, it was an incredibly bad fail. We lost so many points in the lead up to the Olympics, but if we kept being worried about what happens if we fail, if we set this goal and we fail, that's it. If we start to think about, and I like that question, but I don't like that question because it's like, I don't want to even contemplate failing. Because if we start thinking about failing, it can get really big in our head and we can start to prepare to fail. Does that kind of make sense? You can look at it two different ways. A glass is half full or a glass is half empty. You know, half empty or half full. It's your decision on how to view it.
It's neither. It's just a bottle of water.
And you know what?
So profound.
When I said it like, exactly, it's just a bottle of water. Perfect.
What I'm trying to say is, you absolutely right. But if it's the individual's mindset of how you treat failure.
Exactly. So you're going to have to fail many times to get to the point where your goal might not come to fruition, right? So to get the goal, we had to fail many times. We had to learn how to fail to get the goal. We had to kind of fail forward. So we also had to focus on a positive outcome. We had to go, how can we make it better? And if we had failed and got a silver or a bronze, you know what? I've learned so much. I wrote a book about it all. That book's not about winning a gold medal. It's about what we did to win a gold medal.
I think that's
Yeah. Is that the answer that you're looking for? Yeah. The answer is in my book. No. It's
the
what
book
you
of
do.
The week.
Yeah. It's what you do to that. It's also how you react to that fail. Like, I think if we had failed, I don't think I'd be any... Sure, I would not have maybe got as many opportunities because I only won silver or bronze.
And the lady would have cleaned the toilet.
Yeah, lady would clean the toilet, and I might not have been saying.
He's very dirty now.
It's how you get back up, you know, and I think we've got to be careful not to prepare to fail. Not to think, oh, okay, if my athletes fail and don't get this goal. If you're thinking that, I'm not saying you are, but if you're thinking that, the way you talk to your athletes is going to sound like that too. You're not going to talk with confidence. Because when you really believe, you have a posture, right? Do you have a posture when you believe in something? You're like, yeah, when you tell your kid, no, you can't cross the road because there are cars coming. You'll get run over. You know that. You have a posture about that with your kid. But if you go, oh, well, maybe you can cross the road. Just watch out. It might be okay. And then, boom, you get hit. So, exactly. But do you understand?
No second chances. No.
Do you understand the posture about your belief in your athletes is incredibly important? If they feel like you don't believe in them or in their goal, if you have this doubt, then they will have a doubt. So you need to fill yourself with so much. My coach, he never ever showed, he may have had it, felt it, but he never showed that he ever doubted us. So there was no way we could kind of get any sort of doubt or fear from him. He was just the most positive man. Like, there was this girl in the other Australian team who had a terrible action with the way she set her hands. Terrible. But he would never, ever, ever, ever put her down or ever. He would say to her, oh, you're going to be the best setter in the world. That's how he would speak to her, with that sort of posture, to give her the confidence to become as good as she could get, even though she would still maybe not be very good. Do you know what I mean? It's like, it's that belief has to ooze out of you as a coach. And then if they fail, then you just have to scoop them up and love them and then remind them of everything that they've learned. At the end of the day, he had to authentically believe that because he was with us 24 hours a day, all the time, on train, you know, travelling. You know, if he showed any doubt, we would have smelt it. We would have felt it.
And you reacted to it as well.
We would have reacted to it. But what I'm getting at, be careful with the goal thing that's your shared goal, because it has to be their goal, not your goal. It has to be. So that's why they have to do this process. And it's really interesting. There's not been no badminton goals, you know, there's like a career goal, a sabbatical goal, a travelling goal,
retirement
goal.
It's really cool.
It's really cool. It's awesome. It's awesome. It really is awesome to hear everybody's goals. But what I'm hearing is it's their goal. It's his goal. It's her goal. It's his goal. It's just fantastic. So when you do it with the athletes and it's about badminton, it has to truly be their goal. Because it could be their parents. They're saying, come on, play for Australia. I'd love to see you go to the Olympics. Come on. And inside they're going, all I want to do is play piano. Do you know what I mean? And that's their value.
You ask John, you ask him, that is goal. To me, he's accurate.
Yes.
But he has the goal. I'm looking at from my coach point of view here. You know? So John's want to go to say, I'm his coach now. You know, what if?
Can't your goal be to help him achieve his? Like, you don't have to adopt his goal. He just comes to you with his goal, and your goal is to help him succeed.
Yeah,
and
really,
the question with the failure, you know, what if they start thinking about it and we're setting them up to fail and all the rest of it, I would say that it's about building them to be resilient.
Yeah,
like, it's not about building into your goals of, an out clause. It's about saying when things don't go right, they're going to happen, someone's going to crash into your car, your house is going to burn down, something like that. You're a resilient person, and that's where you build someone more than just a player. So you don't say don't have a goal and don't strive to be the best, but you give them enough tools that they're resilient if, in the case that they do fail, they deal with it.
Yeah.
So I don't see a problem with having a massive goal and wanting to be an Olympian and want to be more than a gold medalist and all the rest of it, like you're saying. And you don't need to say that won't work just because they might fail. It's about building a person that's resilient in the case that they do. It's not the end of the world. It's not to not have the goal is the answer to solving failure.
I have an opinion that even if she had been knocked out of the sport, she would have probably made it somewhere else.
Yes.
If the person is taken out of something, but they have that flexibility and that actual, whatever you want to call it, winning or process goals or whatever,
ability, it doesn't matter what you take away from them, that's that you're the one athlete that wants to be an Olympic champion, but you know it's going to be hard behind them, but you still give them good enough tools and then
would you say that to your
athlete? Say what?
Yeah.
No, I would never say that. Because there is no failure in such. You don't have to talk to the athlete about, absolutely not. You talk to the athlete about, right, what do you want to achieve? What are your values? What do you love doing in life? If their values are all about playing the piano and riding horses, but their goal is to go to the Olympics badminton, something wrong there, you know. So that's where you can really start to find out what they want, because then they will do everything they can to get there if it's what they want. And then they'll become the person to get there. You've got to help them to become the person, to be the best of their ability. So there are three types of Olympians. There are Olympians that just go to get the tracksuit. There are Olympians that go to win a medal, and there are Olympians that go to win the whole thing. So, you know, there's going to be athletes that just play badminton because it's a social aspect and they love that community. There's going to be badminton athletes who want to play for Australia, and there's going to be ones that want to get to the Olympics. And then it's going to be, do they want to go for a tracksuit? Do they want to go to win it? You know, so there's all levels of those goals, and you've got to fail forward. You've got to not be afraid of failing. You've got to not be afraid of your athletes failing, because you're there to just pick them back up again, and with the tools that, you know, you've developed, you can help them get back up onto their feet and go again. It really is about who the person is at the end of the day.
Just going back to your original plan, you made a statement, and I don't know whether it was a throwaway statement or not, but you said your plan finished with the party after winning the medal. That's where the plan ended. Whereas current wisdom in most of the Olympic associations and even from IOC is about athlete career pathway, where they go afterwards, planning for the next step to give them the security to create that safe environment to allow them to go 100%.
Yeah. When I said that plan, that was our day plan. That was, we planned out, we wrote what the day looked like. We're going to get up at this time, we're going to eat this, we're going to do that, we're going to pack our bag, we're going to go play, we're going to go do the drug test, blah, 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 and then we'll party. And I did end up in the Bondi Hotel at 1 o'clock in the morning. So that was my party! And no one was there, they'd all gone home, because the game finished at about 3. So, but the plan that we had post that, we did another one. I'm sorry I didn't bring them today to show you, but we did one 2 years later, a Gold Medal Excellence Plan, and the how can we make it better became how can we make us better. So, or no, how can I make us better? So we evolved the plan to the next level, and within the Gold Medal Excellence Plan, you saw that the why, the purpose, there were purposes in there that were greater than winning that gold medal, like to be able to inspire and lift others' hopes and dreams. You know, to increase our income. So we were already thinking past, okay, what are we going to do with the vehicle of the gold medal? So sport is just a vehicle. Sport, you know, while we're in the midst of playing, it's everything. But for me, for my life, it's a vehicle. It can help me do other things that I love to do, that I'm passionate about. Might be the vehicle that earns you enough money to go travel the world.
I think that makes it when if the what maybe society sees as goals of reaching them, that's what makes it worthwhile. They are going to fail in that, but if they've got these tools they can transfer to academics into school and music, whatever the heck they want to do it, then that's just a bump in the road. Inevitably there is only going to be one gold medalist at the 2016 four men singles. Whatever. So, there's going to be, but they're not going to fail. There's going to be injuries. They're not going to fail. They might be the next best coach. They might be the next best business person.
Mm. And remember, our goal was gold medal excellence, too. It was about being excellent in every way as a person. And the gold medal was just going to be picked up along the way. So our goal wasn't even to win the gold medal. It was to live our lives with gold medal excellence. So that's kind of an example of what you can do outside of... outside of just winning a tournament or something. Maybe the goal is, like, who am I going to become when I win this tournament? And I'll just win this tournament so I can become that person. That's another way of looking at it. All right, we're just going to move on. I want you to do, I want you to get your phones out. Everyone get their phone out. And I want you to set a reminder. I want you to put, in fact, I want you to put three reminders in your phone of what you're going to do, to three action steps towards your goal. Happy to talk to somebody to help you get there. Might be to look up the local travel brochures to see where you want to go.
This one, I've already done it in my calendar.
Oh, you've done it. You're ahead, you should be running the session. That's perfect. All right, so you've all got one. To finish off?
5 minutes, yeah.
5 minutes? Okay, last thing I want to do is this. But this might help some of you as well with your athletes. Everybody got one thing? Alright. This is about focus. This is about what you're thinking and where you're thinking. This is Mr. Unhappy or Mrs. Unhappy. This person constantly thinks every single day of the results they're getting in their life right now. And they might be good results or they might not be so good. Let's imagine they're not so good results. Things aren't going well, my life's not on track, relationship issues, I'm not winning my matches, whatever it is. That's what they're focusing on. That's what they're filling their head with. And what is that going to create? Obviously, it's going to create negative thoughts, right? If that's what you're focusing on. And negative thoughts create negative emotions. So if you're thinking negative stuff, you're going to be feeling negative emotions. And because of that, you're going to portray that to the world, and you're going to do negative stuff. So you know when you've had a relationship breakdown or something like that, what do? You might go out and have too many drinks or something. You know, you do negative stuff, or you've had a loss of a game, and you might go and chuck all your stuff in the bin or something. I don't know. You're doing negative stuff. And what does that create? More negative results, right? Because what you're starting off, the thought process starts with what's happening at the moment. And here's how you flip it. It's so easy. You just start with positive thoughts. It doesn't matter what happens to you, it's how you deal with it, right? So you've got to deal with it by filling your mind with positive thoughts. So if you do lose, what did I learn along the way? How can I make it better the next time? What can I do to improve? These are all positive thoughts. Focus on positive thoughts. They'll create positive emotions, which will create positive actions and behaviours, which will obviously create better results and more positive thoughts. So do you see it's just a circle? And we often get stuck focusing here. But what we should, no matter what happens here, we've got to fill our head with positive thoughts. Imagine if Natalie had not walked into that massage room that night and being inspired with a whole lot of positive thoughts. Imagine if she would have come out the next day still being like this. Oh, we're hopeless, we're gonna lose. That's how she felt. But she filled her head, unbeknown to her, it was filled with inspiration and positive thoughts, and it changed everything. So that's just even showing this to your athletes, this little circle, can be really beneficial to them. Because sometimes we just go, oh, that's right, I'm just thinking crap. Okay, does everyone get that? The last activity which we're not going to do is the I am. And this is where you can fill in who do you need to be to reach your goal. So athletes, your athletes, who do they need to be to reach their goal? It might be that they just have to be prompt and on time so they begin training. Right? At the right time. It might be that they have to be focused and attentive when you're talking. Who do they need to be? Get them to fill it in. So then it's on their plan, and then when, if they lose, you can even go back to that and go, right, well, your goal was to do that, but were you this? And they'll go, no, well, hello. Maybe that's where you can improve. So this again is building their mindset. Does that make sense? It's a really nice exercise to do. So it's basically, if I asked you right now to finish the sentence, I am dot, 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 whatever you would write would be what's happening in your life right now. I am whatever. That's who you are. So in order to take the next step, you might have to start saying you're somebody else. You might have to start saying you're more than you are. So for us, we had to start saying, I am an Olympic gold medalist. And we did. we had a creed in here. There's a creed that we wrote and we read out every day. I'm an Olympic gold medalist. I'm the fastest server in the world. Was I? Yes. I was the fastest server in the world. It's my weapon. So I am was really important. Sorry to rush through that, but we have to finish now. It's the teamwork stuff. Where are you going to put your plan? That's really important. Our plan was in our room, everywhere, up in our room. Also in the Olympic Village, we had a scoreboard. We had a scoreboard. So every day we woke up before we played our games, we had a scoreboard there. Our names, our country flag, and then our points we had to get there that day. So if like all of this is feeding our head with positive mindset, every day we're waking up. On the back of this toilet door were the words to the national anthem. How was I going to win a gold medal if I didn't know the words to the national anthem? In 1996, I didn't know the words to Advance Australia Fair. We changed it for years, 20, 30 years ago. When I was in school, we used to sing God Save the Queen as our national anthem, and it changed. Never learned the words. So really, honestly, if you asked me back in 96, did I believe we could win gold? Of course not, because I didn't know the words to the anthem. Of course not. It's just proof that I didn't really believe we could win gold. I sabotaged myself. I didn't do what I had to do it. So I remembered that and I write, right, I've got 2 weeks while we live in the village to make sure I know all the words. And when I stood on that podium and the medal was put around my neck, I was more proud of being able to sing along to the national anthem almost than having that medal around my neck. So you can see that winning is not a fluke. It can be planned, it's goal orientated, it can be fun. We surrounded ourselves with gold. Oh, I didn't know about that. We collected gold stuff. Because if you want something also in your life, you've got to surround yourself with it. If you want a sabbatical and you don't know where you're going to go, get a whole lot of travel vouchers and spread them out on the floor by travel magazines and just have a look and see where you want to go. Like, surround yourself with what you want to achieve. So we had gold colored everything leading into the games. It was fun. People gave it to us for a gift. And eventually reality catches up to your dream. So I hope you guys have taken something away from that. I hope this is the last little bit for my team too. You can get your athletes to fill in who's on their team, who's part of their team. From physios, chiros, mums, dads, media. We have media on our team. We have everybody on our team. We actually drew a rocket ship. And this is Matt and Kerry were up here. We were steering the ship. These are our coaches. These are all the people that were involved in getting us there. These are all the people that looked after our bodies. And we had our families, friends, partners, fans, media. We knew that they were all part of our team. We respected that they were part of our team. It wasn't just Matt and I. So can you see how much effort we put in and how much there was behind that? And that's, you can go to even more. We're just creative. You can do even more than that. Does that help?
Yep.
Is that good?
Yes.
We finish off there. Anyone got any kind of burning questions? And thank you for your question. Thank you all for
your time. Food and break would actually be appropriate.
Yeah. Absolutely.
On the break.
Yeah.
But I'd like to thank Kerry. If you could put your hands together for Kerry. Things on Google about them, so did you do my research? So Richard, be careful. You're